got my daughter and her fiance together on Facebook.
Oh, great. Nice. Nice.
Greetings, everyone. Welcome to the Independent Producers Live Showcase. We got a lot to cover this program, and I'm going to turn it over to Bruce Broussard, and then, of course, his guest, John Sweeney, to the right of him. But, Bruce, go ahead with your comments.
Well, first off, Richard, how you been?
Oh, okay. Yeah,
great. How's our
nice weather.
Nice weather.
That's
weather.
Right.
Evidently, our producers are doing fine because we're getting shows here at PCM, right?
That's right.
And, yeah, so they're all together, right? This is their show, but the fact of the matter is that we at PCM we've got community involvement, right, across the board.
Right.
Okay.
Good. Right.
Well, and like Richard said, I guess I'm going to probably take a lead in on this piece, and basically the guest that we're bringing on today is that we're going to be talking about the presidential platforms.
Okay.
I mean, you know, the platforms have yet to be actually, let's say, they're talking about platforms.
They keep talking.
But they haven't picked them and voted on them, right, as of yet, right?
Okay.
And so I thought maybe one of the areas we may talk about is on the whole issue of guns. You right there?
Sure.
And when you start thinking about the whole issue of firearms, a firearms aspect of it, the organization that comes out just loud and clear is the National Rifles Association, the NRA.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And so now with the advent of all the issues, all the things that have been happening back east and down south, and you know the shootings and this, that, and the other,
right,
with firearms and whatever, I thought that maybe this is an issue that also should be a part of the discussion with both presidential candidates.
Okay.
Yeah, well, now we got a third. We got a third one, the Libertarian parties too. We got the Libertarian Party, we got the Republican Party, and Democrat. These are the green party. But the ones that are on the ballot, ballot.
Okay.
Those are the three major ones. But regardless, all these other entities should be talking about this issue.
Okay.
But better yet, the NRA should lead that discussion. Why not? You know what I mean?
Okay.
Because
they
were kind of like the ones that really lobbied to get the Second Amendment, right? The right to bear arms.
That's right.
And so now, right. so anyway, so what we thought we'd do is that we'd bring our own local authority on the issue.
Okay.
And you might recognize this guy. His name is John Sweeney. He's right. Been on the Oregon Voters Digest for a number of years. And John's spent a lot of time on the whole issue of firearms. I've had him on the show many times over. He's an Oregonian. He's got a good record and whatever. And he'll speak his mind. And so we'll just have this discussion about firearms. But again, like I said, the NRA should be at the table. They should be at
involved.
The table. They should be involved
That's
in the process.
Right.
And so we're going to let John talk.
Okay.
About and bring us up to date. And then every so often we will sort of like inject our piece.
Okay.
Questions. Or anything you feel that he's not brought up to the table, guess what? We'll just break right on in and ask him
That's
the
right.
question. So, John, why don't you start off by identifying yourself, and then at the same time, how you got involved with firearms and this, that, and the other, and what's your definition of the NRA and any other, and then organizations that are local, if you will. So we just want you to talk about guns. We're going to try to hopefully motivate the NRA and its members and others on that other side, if you will, who knows guns, to call, if you will, the congressmen and whatever, the people who are going to be actually at the platform, whether it be the Republican Party, the Democratic Party, the Green Party, like Richard has said, or the Libertarian Party, or whomever. But the whole idea is that needs to be on the table, because there's a lot of questions being asked as to, especially this whole issue with the AR-15, and then the tanks, by the way. We talked about the tanks and the bazookas and all kinds of things, you know what I mean? There's a whole bunch of things or whatever. So we're going to give you the opportunity to talk, and I'm going to quit, and then I'm going to let you talk. So introduce yourself, then talk about firearms, how you got into firearms, and how you got were able to be licensed as a concealed weapon. How do you feel about that program? And then just go right through the deal, and then talk about the kinds of weapons that are at these gun shows, and what you see there. And just lay it on out. So the idea is we want to educate the public too at the same time. Okay,
yeah.
Good on, John.
I'm John Sweeney. I'm a native Oregonian. I was actually born in Glenada, down on the coast across from Florence on the Sayula River. And first time I was shooting, my dad took me out in the woods there with a .38 snubby, and you know, it climbed way over my head, but I was fairly good at it. And
how old were you then?
Six.
6 years old. Jeez, you see that? Isn't that something?
So I've been shooting for 70 years.
70 years?
70 years. And I've shot just about everything. And I'm a life member of the National Rifle Association and Citizens Committee for the Right to Keep and Bear Arms and Gun Owners of America.
Now, what's that last thing? That right to bear arms. Is that a different group?
That's a different group. And they're out of the Seattle, Washington area.
Oh.
Which they also have the Second Amendment Foundation. I belong to the Jews for the Preservation of Firearms Ownership.
Okay.
I'm not Jewish, but you don't have to be. Was a life member of the Law Enforcement Alliance of America. I joined the Tri-County Gun Club out by Sherwood in 1975. I was the president for 5 years. I am a life member of the Oregon State Shooting Association. I was the president there for about 7 years, and during that time I lobbied the Oregon State Legislature in 87, 89, and 91. And I belong to Johnson Creek Gun Club out on Lamphere. Anyway, you lobbied the legislature in 87, 89, and 91, and in 1990, Oregon changed from being a may issue state to a shall issue state.
Mm.
And before the...
And when was that? What time was that?
That actually, the law came into effect in January 1990.
Okay, okay.
And Multnomah County only had 13 permits, see? You had to be somebody special like Dick Bogle and a few other people. And Dick Bogle says he didn't have any in. Well, you know, he's an ex policeman and former policeman.
Once a policeman, always
TV
a policeman.
Guy.
Yeah. And he was a TV guy.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
If you believe that, why I got this bridge in Brooklyn, I'll make you a real deal.
Right. Okay.
Then they changed it, and it's a concealed handgun license.
Okay.
And it's based on the Washington model, and Washington issues concealed handgun licenses to citizens of Washington and surrounding states, which means Oregon and Washington.
And when did Oregon get that passed?
That was changed in 1990.
1990.
And Oregon will issue to Oregon residents and surrounding states, which is Washington, Idaho, Nevada, and California.
Okay.
They don't recognize other states. They don't have the reciprocity. They're working on the reciprocity in Congress so that, just like your driver's license, if you have it one state, it's good everywhere. And
so you can carry your firearm if you're licensed in one particular state throughout any other
right.
states, right?
Okay. And the there's about 13 million people with concealed handgun licenses of one form or another. And depending on the state, Washington, 20% of them belong to women, and Oregon's about a third. And it runs between 20% to almost 40%, depending on the state.
Mm-hmm.
And it is shown that people with concealed handgun licenses are more law-abiding than the general population. And the criminal element, statistically, is 2%. And half of those are into white-collar crimes. You know, think Bernie Madoff, who stole billions and billions for decades and decades,
mm-hmm.
until the feathers hit the fan.
Yeah.
And then you have the other 1% that are into physical crimes, and about 50 to 60%, they're into stealing stuff, you know, your bicycle, your car, and getting your house and stuff. And so only about 40% or so are in person crime, which are they're going to pick your pocket or kill you and anything in between.
Mm-hmm.
Now, another interesting fact just came out that they call them hot burglaries. What that is a nice way of saying home invasion. And I've had a few friends who were victims of home invasion. And one of them says, you know, combat in the Philippines was better than being a victim of a home invasion. And what it runs is that in restrictive areas like Chicago and New York and Washington, D.C., you're more likely to be home about 41% of the time, whereas in your less restrictive areas, it's only about 11%. And so that's the latest thing. And the fact that you know, they look at Bernie Sanders, you know, and I'm a registered Democrat, and the deal is he was got on the gun control bandwagon, but he's from Vermont. Vermont has almost no gun control laws. In fact, the deal is they're one of the first states where you didn't need a permit to carry. And the fact is, they have very little crime, you know. And
so they carry them openly and all this that and the other.
They stress of carrying it concealed.
Okay, stress concealed. Okay.
Concealed, you know, and there's places where it's okay to carry it in the open, and that really works when you're out, say, hunting or backpacking or something. But to run around town with one, it does make some people nervous, and. I know a lot of people have firearms and they're carrying them all the time. Doesn't bother me a bit, see? You guys could have guns now and it wouldn't bother me a bit, see? So.
Well, we're not carrying. So you.
Oh, yeah.
But you went through the process. In fact, let me ask you about that. But what's the process? I mean, what are the kind of questions do they ask a person for trying to qualify for a concealed license?
Concealed handgun license.
And who can qualify?
Okay. You have to be 21 years old and a citizen of the United States. Mm-hmm. You have to be a resident of the county, because now you have to live in the county to get one.
So in Oregon, in Portland, it will be Multnomah County.
That is correct.
Okay.
Well, there's a little shave that's in Washington County.
Okay. But you have to go to the county.
No. Yeah. No felonies, no violent misdemeanors within the last 4 years. Have a training certificate. Because I was a military officer that qualified for the training. You're being in the Marine Corps and the National Guard, that would qualify you. And
or would he have to go through something again?
Yeah.
Probably not.
Oh. What about the others? What kind of training?
For the others, there's training courses all over the places.
I see.
Now,
You pay for those.
Yeah, you pay for that. And some people saying, well, there's no shooting requirement to the training.
Right.
But you know, it's knowing when to shoot sometimes is a lot more important than on how good a shot you are. And in fact, some of the states that had training requirements, they had to have 80 or 90% hits on a target. You know, a police officer is only required to have 50% hits.
Hmm.
Oh. And, you know, that's why they're such sloppy shots, you know.
Portland, you know, man?
Well.
Or just police in general?
In general.
Now, in the state.
Now the thing is, if you're out and about, and you see a policeman carrying a revolver, police agencies that carry revolvers, they shoot less and hit more. You know, like two police officers, a young lady committed suicide by cop, and she had a gun taped to her hands, and they're shooting at her at about 15 feet, and they fired 41 rounds. Now they had to reload,
Jeez.
And they only hit her 19 times.
Jeez.
And she was a stationary target, see?
Jeez.
And they really get freaked out sometimes. Says, you know, I shoot metallic silhouette, and I have to shoot at a target 200 yards away. And they just have panic, see?
Really? Really?
Yeah. And in fact, once in a while, they show up at Tri-County Gun Club and says, well, how about trying a PRC, which is the police revolver course. And you start off shooting at 25 yards, 75 feet. And I says, God, that's a long way. Well, no. And I says, you know, I was a military policeman in the National Guard. The deal is, I had a 45, and it had to do everything. And the deal is, a 45 caliber bullet only drops about this far at 100 yards, and a 9mm only drops this far, so.
Mm-hmm. Hmm.
And they trained us to walk the dogs.
Well, let's get back to this qualifying for a concealed weapon. Like, do they go through training as far as a firearm? If in fact they're not former military, then they go through training. Is that a requirement?
The requirement basically is it's teaching you about the law,
but not to actually shooting a firearm.
Now you go to the place to shoot out on Hayden Meadows. They take you through a shooting.
But is that a requirement?
It's not a requirement. Some places that have
what about Portland, Multnomah County, let's say? Multnomah
it's
County.
Not a requirement, but when you go to the places where you're going to get the training, they normally have a shooting part to make it good.
But that's optional.
It's legally optional,
okay.
But most places, but a lot of instructors that teach it like to actually be on a range and have people shoot so that they know what they're getting into, see.
Any idea of who who take the optional to either train and or not train?
Most
ideas, any thoughts on that?
Most of the people really get into it, you know, because they want to know. And the instructor's saying, you know, you need to know what happens when you pull that trigger, you know, because it's not like this pin where I'm holding, you know, when you shoot that thing, there's a reaction.
Right.
And the thing is that, you know, some people they're saying, well, you need to have 45 or something like that. Well, you know, a hit with a 22 will be to miss with a 45 every day of the week. But most of them, they like to have them do the shooting because it makes a difference. And some places where they're actually teaching in town, say their classes in a garage, they'll at least have experience with a air pistol. And some of the air pistols now are multi-shots, where you just pull the trigger and you get several shots.
Tell me something. Let me ask you this question too. I'm looking at the mindset now. I mean, what makes a person want to have a concealed weapon? Well, why does a person want to have a concealed weapon?
Well,
what's the purpose for a concealed weapon?
Well, it keeps from making a lot of people real nervous, because some people they see a firearm and they just go nuts, you know. But you know, you say you're in a business attire, you know, and the deal is that you want to have the protection for some reason. The deal is you don't want to display it, so you you have it concealed, and it just works better. And
do you feel safer?
Well, the deal is when you're carrying, you actually, if you're smart, you'll actually place restrictions on yourself. You know, somebody starts mouthing off, the deal is you find someplace else to go.
But then my point is that you're going, Rich.
Well, I had a totally separate question.
Yeah, go on, no problem.
185th and Powell, what shooting range is that?
185th and. Wellers off 174th, and that's the Portland Gun Club.
Okay.
And it's a shotgun club, and they shoot trap and skeet and sporting clays and stuff like that.
So. It's not a training place.
They will teach you to handle shotguns and to do trap and skeet and sporting clays. And shotguns are nice, you know.
Okay, and then a question. I it's been a long time since I've seen a rifle on the back of a pickup.
Mm-hmm.
Do they still do that? Are they still supposed to do that?
You're allowed to do that, you know. And
in Portland?
I thought they wanted.
In Oregon?
Yeah,
but,
yeah, you could drive around with it, but most people don't. Yeah, most people don't.
But you can.
You can, yeah.
Okay, that's not in the conceal. They've been doing that before, right?
Oh, yeah, it has nothing to do with it. Okay. Because the concealed handgun license or concealed weapons permits and all those things, it's for standard handguns. Now, where you're talking about a conventional revolver or a semi-automatic pistol.
Mm-hmm. Well, now concealed, like you said, something you don't visibly see, right?
Right.
But in all due respect, when you start thinking about the shootings and whatever, people are actually carrying weapons and rifles on their shoulders openly.
Mm-hmm.
Is that concealed?
No, but the deal is.
What's the rationale behind that?
Okay, but that's the. Rifles and shotguns have different rules for carries.
But what's the rationale? We're not hunting in the city, are we?
Well, let's hope not. Let's hope not. That's
I don't know.
Well, what's the deal?
Well, some of these people they just want to kind of confront you one way or the other. See, we're making a statement. You know, I have a couple shotguns and a couple rifles, and I would not carry one around.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's. If I needed, I'd have it handy, but the deal is I wouldn't be walking around carrying it, so, you know, flashing it, so.
The incident to do with the, that caused the policeman to get killed and the two situations where the police shot someone, mm-hmm. There was a concealed weapon involved in that. Do you know anything more about that?
Well, I don't have any more information than what I saw on mm-hmm. television.
Okay.
And the thing is that I understand that he told the police officer he had a concealed,
right.
had a concealed handgun license, and he had a weapon on him, and he was reaching for his ID. The trouble is, whether you're carrying a weapon or not, you'll get pulled over by the police. you want to have your hands and everybody else's hands in plain sight, and you don't make any moves until they tell you.
Yeah.
Because they are just...
Oh, I asked you a question.
And the deal is...
Give me your license.
Yeah, they're just so jumpy, you know. And
so who's jumping? Both?
The cops.
The police are.
Okay, yes.
Right. See, the deal is they Don Clark became the sheriff of Multnomah County, and then they got the push for having all cops have a college degree, see. Well, you know, there's a small portion of those people who've gone all the way through school and college, become policemen, who have never had a job, never sweated for their own money. So they have no reference point to anybody else, because they never worked before. And so, and the deal is, they keep saying the emphasis for safety, but the deal is, you know, being a policeman is kind of a risky job, and the deal is, that's what you sign on for, you know. And some of them, you have this, what you call contempt the cop. You know, the deal is, you don't do what they want, or you say no, they get all jacked out of shape. The deal is, I was a security guard and as an MP, and the deal is, my bosses asked, well, how come you're not having trouble? I says, because, well, the security company, they weren't interested in arrest. But I says, I approached them, and I explained things, and I allowed them to back down with their pride. You look at how the cops do it now, they get in your face, and they want to take your pride away. And, you know, it's like a football game. You know, you got the ball, you're the accused, and they want to pigpile you.
But is that part of that training, you think?
I think recently, you know it's had a friend of mine that's retired now with a policeman, and his police demeanor is a lot different than we're just sitting here talking, see. But the deal is that they have the thing about controlling the suspect, you know, and they're real big on handcuffing people, see. It used to be they never got into that, you know, until it was finally time. And they like to do their arrests at night because they get a lot of overtime.
Mm. Oh.
See, because the deal is, you know, for a lot of people, you'd call up, say they're accused of some crime, says you could call them up and say, look, we got a warrant for your arrest, you know. Call your lawyer and have him make arrangements, you come down.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think Michael Jackson was going to turn himself in and had it all arranged, and the cops jumped him out in front of the building.
Mm.
See, so it's about controlling the suspect, mm-hmm. See.
But there's been these situations where the police have been there and the person in the car just shot him right in the face.
Yeah.
Stuff like that. That's what makes them so jumpy.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. But that's why he made the point about these folks, they made them degree-oriented type situation. They've never had any background whatsoever in firearm, and in many cases, they weren't even military.
In fact, when they have times of lots of people in military, the pre-training with firearms, they have it before they become policemen. But there's when you have big gaps of peace, you have a lot of times where the policemen, in fact, before this Desert Storm and all that, they said actually about 85% of the officers had never handled a gun before.
Mm-hmm.
See, and so then, and you know, and a lot of them figured, well, I carry a gun all the time, so I'm an expert. Well, let me tell you, there's a lot of firearms up there that are really tricky to handle. Mm-hmm. And I remember, I think he was about 7 years old, and they had a newsreel, and they had this expert, was 87 years old, and he picked up a gun, and a lot of the old guns had some external mechanism. He picked it up, and it started to slip, and he squeezed it, and it went off. And he was really embarrassed, and he was recognized as an expert. But a lot of the modern, almost all of the modern firearms are a lot safer to handle than the older ones. And that's why they say if you don't have to, don't pick it up, you know, mm-hmm. because unless you know exactly what it is.
Mm-hmm.
It's like the NRA has the Eddie the Eagle. If you see it, leave the room and tell an adult, but don't touch it.
What was that?
Eddie the Eagle.
Eddie the Eagle.
Yeah.
Now, what's Eddie the Eagle doing?
Well, Eddie the Eagle is a program for young people. Is that, you know, you come across a firearm, leave it alone, exit the room and tell an adult so they can come take care of it.
I see. Yeah. And where do they do that?
Hmm?
And that's just something that they say you should do?
That's what you train young kids to, and that's what they're supposed to do. And it is, and accidents and homicides and all that has actually been going down steadily from the 1950s.
Okay, let's talk about that for a minute as far as training and educating our young people and whatever. And what comes to mind is the NRA. You remember the NRA, the National Rifle Association. Do they have any kind of a program where they are educating young people into the schools? People who are not in the out in the woods or something hunting or this, that, and the other.
Eddie the Eagle is the one that they try to get into the schools, and a lot of schools have adopted Eddie the Eagle.
They have adopted it.
Of course,
you know whether or not they're adopted here within Multnomah County?
What, these lefties in Multnomah County? Are you kidding?
Well, you're part of the club. Aren't you a Democrat? Huh?
Yeah, I know, but you know.
Huh? Well, you could easily get that here in Multnomah County, couldn't you?
You kidding? With those lefties, I mean.
Really? Like.
They're looser than a goose with diarrhea.
Well, you got, you got Senator, what's her name? She lives here in Portland, Multnomah County.
Which senator do you talk about?
Senator, the one who basically identifies with the whole issue of gun control.
Oh, Jenny Burdick?
Jenny Burdick.
Oh, she's
here locally, right?
Oh, yeah, she's the puppet that can't talk for herself.
But she's talked about this. I mean, she's very passionate about that.
Oh, piece. Yeah, well, that's the whole thing, and they talk
what do
about...
You think, what do you think her passion is about that?
To get reelected.
To get reelected.
Yeah, and so she has that clique that backs her up, and she mouths this... gun control, and they say, well, it's just an Earl Blumenauer saying reasonable controls. And all the deal is, it's just like being in a big pan of water, and you just keep turning the heat up and up and up. And you know, the places where they've had these great firearms bans, the deal is maybe firearms assaults and homicides go down, but the deal is other forms of killing and assaults go up. In fact, in Connecticut and Rhode Island, they had, you commit a crime with a firearm, it's 5 years on top of everything else. Firearm homicides went down, and firearm assaults went down. But overall, it's homicides and assaults went up. Mm-hmm. And the deal is that actually firearms are not a good murder weapon because of the hysteria and your chances of getting caught if you use a firearm. I mean, the deal is you use a $5 ice pick out of a convenience store, plus the fact you're not making any noise, you're not waking people up, and you might lay there for a long time before they find you. Hmm. And you know, it's like that show 48 Hours, you know, they figure they got to do it in 48 hours. See? Hmm. They don't find you for several days, it could be real tough.
Well, let's get back to the NRA for a minute. I'm thinking, I mean, what are some of the things as a member you get out of that course? I mean, you talked a little bit about the youth piece aspect of it. Mm-hmm. But what are some of the things that they do, if you will, to talk to gun safety, whether or not you should carry a concealed weapon, why you should and where should you carry one along that line? What kind of weapon, if you will, should you use?
Firearm.
Well, but my point still, a firearm. But but naturally, I'm interested in this whole piece about the fact that this AR-15 and IE, you can even buy a tank with weapon with the
yeah.
With, I mean that's all
I'm
that kind of stuff.
About that.
You know what I'm saying? But you got to be very well qualified. That's pretty much so. Meaning that everybody can't get a tank, right?
That's correct.
But if
it
you
costs
have
lots and lots and lots of money.
Money. So if you ain't rich and you got any money, you can't get a tank, right? Got
right.
me. But so the little people can't get the tank. So my point is that I went off a little bit. But what does the NRA do for you? When you, as a member?
Well, they tell me who the good candidates are for office and the bad candidates, and I have a real fine magazine that is educational, and they talk about history, and they talk about new products, not just firearms, but other things. And
what about safety, things like that, and getting it into school? And for instance, I'm a product of ROTC when I was going to high school. Mm-hmm. And we were taught, naturally, we fired a .22, and we had competition and things of that nature. So we learned gun safety, and that's my point. Mm-hmm. So my point is that what is the NRA doing in reference to trying to educate the young people, if you will? Do they do things like
that? They have programs, and they have competitions all over the place, and they have competitions by age group. So you have people that are less than 12 that are 12 or less that are shooting. Then you have teenagers, and then young adults. And
but is this in the educational system?
Well, The competition, you also, you have the education and the safety and all that goes together because they just, and usually you work.
But they're not in the schools, that's what I'm saying.
They're not in most of schools in Oregon and some of the other lefty places, but you have nice places where they're in. And usually a lot of times they're working through their state affiliates.
I know you've been using the word lefty for quite some time, but I understand. But the fact of the matter is, that's the problem. What if you were to educate the lefties as to the benefits, if you will, of carrying a weapon? I mean, let's throw it out. I mean, that's the issue.
Well, what's
and then they can get all the vote they want if it didn't just start going around. Because the lefties are saying, hey, you're killing folks, and some people are having guns and they shouldn't have guns, and we got this mass shooting, we got all kinds of things, we got this terrorism thing and whatever. I mean, I'm afraid. And then you've got these young people, as you say, that will get on the force, they've got their degrees and whatever, and they got scared, like Richard was saying. These people, that guy that shot that young man, who basically, he asked him for his license. And then he reached for the license and he got shot.
Yeah.
And you know, and I could see also too, he was scared. The name of the game is that when he said, I've got a license to rent, all of a sudden he kind of in his own mind said, hey, this man has a gun like I have a gun. Well,
you said there was something else about that.
Yeah, what's that deal?
Well, the deal is that...
But don't get away from that other piece now, okay, about the left.
But it's the deal is that they need to realize somebody has a concealed handgun license. They've gone through the same background check as a police officer has.
So why didn't he understand?
Who knows?
No, but wait a minute now.
Well, the guy was black. See,
now we're getting down to... I didn't say anything about that. But now, since we brought the issue up, now we can talk from a historical standpoint, right?
Yeah, and the deal
What's the
is,
deal?
Let's talk about the lefties for a second.
Don't call them lefties.
All right.
If you want to say Democrat,
but then, aren't liberal.
He's a Democrat. I mean, let's see, because he's talking about, you know, Jenny Berger, she happens to be a Democrat. She's not a lefty.
Right.
You don't call her a lefty, would you? She's just Jenny. She was
being
elected.
Being nice, I call her lefty.
Well, but she was
I
elected
don't want to burn
to
off the mic.
You didn't vote for her, right?
She doesn't live in my area, but I wouldn't have voted for her anyway.
Well, not
she ran for mayor. I didn't vote for her.
Wait a minute. Well, okay. We'll get off of Jenny for a minute. Hopefully, I can get Jenny to come on and share with her.
Oh yeah.
She could share, if you will, to the public about what's her reasoning, what's her passion, why is she so adamant about the whole issue of firearms. Fair? Is that fair? Would you be there? You'd be there with her, right?
Sure.
But that's why we're giving everybody the opportunity to hear what you have to say. You're a good guy.
But I have some friends that are sort of say liberal, and I get them out every so often to shoot, and all of a sudden, hey, this is fun. No wonder you guys like these things,
And are there women there too? A whole bunch of women?
Oh yeah, you know. And
what's the count? 50-50 or
something like that? And
I thought it was about 80-10 or something, 80-20, and the other 10 is just looking.
But
right?
Yeah. Well, I go camping up there in the Ochocos, and
come on, it's a male thing, right? In many ways, it's a male thing.
Oh,
it's something to do.
You ought to see those women shoot. You know, and the deal is, when you have international shoots, they're just fascinated by American women shooters, you know, because the deal is, they've seen the Westerns where the guy gets bumped off and the gal steps out behind a pot and, you know, and bang, 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 drops the enemy, you know, so.
So who's the enemy?
Well, in the movie, see.
Yeah, but. And I'm talking about the real life there. We went around. Is that the mindset? But my point that develops that mindset that there are certain colors of people and all this other good stuff that they are the enemies. Watch them.
Well, I belong to Tri-County Gun Club, and this Saturday they're going to have a 600-yard shoot with
600-yard shoot.
Yeah.
Shooting at what?
Well, targets. And I've been out.
What are the images on the targets?
They're bullseyes.
Bullseyes?
Yeah.
What do you mean a bull? I mean, I'm a novice at this.
The
stuff.
Hell you are! You were in the Marine Corps.
I'm a novice. Come on now.
You were in the Marine Corps, and everybody's a rifle.
No. It's the age factor, right, Richard? I mean, I've been around so long that sometimes I kind of figured out. You know what I mean? I like shooting rabbits.
And they have about 20 guys get up there and shoot, and I've been to about three or four of those shoots. And there's a couple of black guys, and there's a couple of Asian guys, and a couple of Mexican guys.
Oh.
So it isn't just a white guy thing. And there's some women out there shooting.
What are their names? Give me some names.
I never asked their name.
Okay.
All I can tell you.
I just threw that out to you. You know that.
That's all right. And the deal is there's some women that shoot, you know, and they do real well.
Okay. But let's get back to that NRA stuff in terms of your benefits.
They're steadier. I think they're steadier.
Yeah.
Well, a lot of times these people, in all due respect, the military, they got military background, you got me, in most cases. They know how to handle a weapon because they've been taught. I mean, in the military, and we went through the same process, the Marine Corps for sure, because you got to be a rifleman when you get out of boot camp. You got to know what the heck you got.
Yeah, right.
And you just don't just start shooting anybody and everybody. You know what I mean? You're not scared. You know, you have to do what you have to do. But it's not about just, quote, shoot first and then ask questions later.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? You got it? Fair?
Yeah.
You went through the same training.
Yeah.
Okay, now let's get back to the NRA piece. What else did you learn about NRA? I mean, we didn't get, okay, the schools, they're not in the schools.
They're not, in a lot of schools are not, but they work through their state affiliates, and some states are more successful than others, you know, like in Texas and New Mexico and Arizona and like Mississippi, and some of those are real successful. Iowa, some of those rural areas, the real.
Now, let's get to another area that's kind of interesting. Well, what kind of weapons are being sold at these gun shows that you've been aware of? What do you see out there on the
Well, they have rifles and pistols and shotguns, and they have, once in a while they have a class 3 dealer that's selling a full auto, but
What's that?
Full auto.
A full auto. What's a full auto?
You know, like a Thompson submachine gun, which is actually a selective fire. Oh. But you go through a special process. Fill out a BATFE form, which is Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms and Explosives, and that's from the National Firearms Act of 1934.
Okay.
And it's a $200 stamp, and you go. It takes about 6 weeks, mm-hmm. and you fill it out, and usually the local sheriff signs off on it, and it goes through the process, and then you can get one. And in fact, they have the Oregon Automatic Weapons Association, and they have their matches a couple times a year, and I've been able to go down there, and I've got to shoot Thompson submachine guns and real assault rifles, none of this fake stuff that you're talking about, you know, and so...
Fake? What do you mean? What's
well, these AR-15s are MSRs, yeah. Modern Supporting Rifles, because if you look at them, they don't have bayonet lugs on them, and they're not selective fire, and a few other things, you know, that make them a real assault rifle.
But they can be changed.
Illegally. Illegally, see, but
people do that, you know that. In our country, we do that. Now, the thing is the other side.
If you jaywalk out on the street and somebody deliberately run over you, that's illegal too, right?
Which one, illegal to walk in?
People break the law. See?
Yeah, but those rounds, they could come in. Now, what about, are there any restrictions on the, let's say on the machine guns and whatever, in terms of once a person gets a license, do they have any kind of restriction from the standpoint, you can't take it out the home, you got to get it all?
The most of them, people, because of the value of the firearms, because they have to be registered with a BATFE prior to sometime in 1986.
Okay.
So the more modern stuff you can't have. So you're the older stuff, and it gets to be more and more valuable. So it's
like a piece of antique. Right?
Oh yeah, and they're
selling these weapons all the time, but they can still fire.
Oh yes, and but the deal is, and in fact, the executive director, he said that he's been dead for a couple of years. He says the only registered machine gun with a registered owner, which happened to have been a MAC-10. Was an undercover Ohio policeman did a contract hit on a drug dealer. So the the registered full auto and selective firearms and suppressors have not been used by their registered owner to commit a crime.
Well, when you start thinking about drug dealer aspect, there you bring another aspect because
but they're not legal. See,
they're not legal, but they are now.
Marijuana
is legal.
Yeah.
Can they find
that's
out
a drug,
their background somehow?
For what's that?
Anybody in drugs? Are they able to trace that out?
Well, I don't know about the medical marijuana and recreational because that's not my thing. You know, I never did drugs and never smoked, so the deal is.
Than heroin.
But states are, well, you know,
stuff.
Well, all of it is almost, it's all legal because you can get it.
Okay.
Right, you know what I'm saying? You
okay. Got
it?
Oh, yeah.
Because we treat it, right? You know, when people get caught up in heroin and whatever, mm-hmm. and even if it's illegal, we treat them, right?
Oh, yeah. We have to do that.
You pick up the tab for that, right?
That's right. We do.
Okay, all right, good. Let's go back to this one point. You made another point in regards to, we started talking about this guy getting shot in the car, which I think is a very important piece. And I think it's good that we're talking. You know, and I would recommend very strongly that if you are out there looking at this particular show, have these discussions. Very important. Mm-hmm. Just share whatever's on your mind, because we're sitting in a situation right now. We need to talk. Yep. I mean, that visual is still sitting in there on everybody's face, because all these kids have that weapon, this other weapon that's out here right now, right? What is it called? This one.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
This one right here. This is the new weapon. Yeah.
Well, you know, what's really amazing,
right? Is fair.
What's really amazing is you see these cops still doing stupid things.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there's cameras everywhere.
Right, right.
That's right.
And you know, and this guy that got shot by the policeman, the training I had to deal is you want to stand behind so they'd have to turn. So he was standing almost looking at him when mm-hmm. he did the shooting.
Yeah, right.
So the deal is he wasn't using reasonable approach mm-hmm. anyway. Mm-hmm. And the deal is so and not realizing or somehow or his brain fade, the fact he says he's had a concealed handgun license or something like that. It's the same background that the police go through. Mm-hmm. Of course, the deal is you got crooked cops, you know, and cops that don't work out, but the deal is I don't know what went through his mind, the fact that he lost it. Of course, the thing is, it's still, you get stopped by the police, you don't make any moves until they ask you to. Mm-hmm. And now in most states, you don't have to tell the cop that you have a firearm until they ask. See, mm-hmm. and...
But if something happens, and then you get shot, then you get searched, and then all of a sudden there's a firearm. And a lot of times people are thinking about whether or not it was put on them, depending upon who they shot.
It's illegal.
Yeah, whether it's legal, right. You see what I mean? It's a legal deal.
Some cops do carry a throwdown.
Yeah. See, and you know, so I guess we got to get right back to the training piece. Because I think about, you know, when you, just like when we were going through boot camp and this, that, and the other, we were being trained, and we were firing at targets and this, that, and the other. But those weren't real human beings.
It depends.
It's not. They're not real human beings. So sometimes it depends upon your background, your exposure. Mm-hmm. All of a sudden, you get out there on the field, and now you got Viet Cong sitting up in the front of you, and this, that, and the other, and all of a sudden you fired someone, and they fall, mm-hmm. and they're there with blood, and this, that, and the other. That's a major shock.
Yeah.
Some people can keep going, and some people can't.
Yeah.
And I'm just saying, now we're sitting in the police department is considered a paramilitary anyway, right? Got me?
Because they've so militarized, I think they've lost their, they've really got this them and us thing rather than we.
But the bottom line is that now they're back home here, and we're not the enemy.
Yeah.
But the mindset is still there. So my point is, where is the training? I mean, and that's what I was saying about the NRA from the standpoint, we got to start somewhere, like the schools and whatever, since we got all these guns out on the streets now, and you don't have to worry about buying them anywhere. You can buy them on the street. You know, you can buy them easily because many folks have more than 5 or 10 guns in their house. People break in the house and they steal the guns, and then they sell them, right? Because people in business sell the guns.
Turn them in for $200 in the right cities.
That's right. So my point is that you asked the Griff the question. I'd like to know a little bit more about the training. I really would, you know.
Okay.
And then the idea of the applicants that are wanting to be police, like we were just really talking about. I agree with you. I mean, I think when they did the rush thing about the so-called education piece, you have to have a degree or whatever. Mm-hmm. I mean, when you start thinking about how they were selecting officers before, you know, in all due respect, the whole idea of the uniform is the deterrent.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and then the idea of the physical size of a person and whatever. That all has something to do with reference to being able to tell that person that I'm an authority. You don't necessarily have to shoot first, right? And everybody that I've talked with, you know, about that piece back when, I mean, these officers look like officers. They would look like brutes. They were big guys.
Right.
And they wouldn't pull their weapon. They'd pull a slapstick out on you. You may have a sore head at the end of the day.
Oh, okay.
But you wasn't shot.
Yeah, it's
and is that's, that fair? You understand? Yeah.
You know, like Portland and Multnomah County had two of the best looking police uniforms anywhere.
Yeah.
And look at Portland now; has got a black uniform like the L.A. You know, mm-hmm, and mm-hmm. then the Multnomah County's wearing those green dungarees. You know, mm-hmm. like they crawl out from under a dirty truck.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, so where's your respect? You know, yeah. because you don't have that professional look. You know, when somebody walks up, you know, you got somebody in coveralls and you got somebody in a suit, mm-hmm. who are you naturally going to respect right off the bat?
Mm-hmm. You're right.
Mm-hmm. See, because right. if you're kind of grubby, the deal is you kind of got to earn that respect. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Whereas if you have the a nice set of clothes or a suit or nice uniform, it speaks for you. Mm-hmm. And so all you have to do is follow through.
So are these, is our county and our city getting the advantage of these good, better clothes, or saying you should wear these?
No, the deal is they've gone from wearing the two-tone blue, and they had yes. the blue epaulets and yep. and that. And then
City of Roses on the car and all that kind of.
Yeah, but their uniforms, that black uniform like L.A. and New York and a few other places, and then in Multnomah County, they're wearing a green coverall.
Well, you got to ask yourself the question: who makes those decisions? You know, who signed the paperwork? I mean, you know, the artist comes in and does this, that, and the other, and we need to have that discussion. But ultimately, the person who's in charge is us, right?
Yes, that's right.
Because we elect the mayor, right, and city mm-hmm. council people, to represent us,
right? Right.
And so, guess who signs the deal? Indirectly, we do.
Okay.
So we got to be a little bit more observant about who we elect to office. Fair?
Yeah, well, it could have been that they figured, well, these type of uniforms are easier to care for and they're cheaper, but the deal is it's an image thing that's gone away, and image is a lot.
Yes, it does. It does. Yeah.
I mean, you know, that's why a lot of people join the Marine Corps for that fancy uniform.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
Didn't you?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. No problem. I mean, it was we were recognized.
And yeah. There was an article in the paper saying businesses are allowing their new employees to dress down because they need to do that in order to get the employees mm-hmm. to be able to hire the employees.
Yeah. Well, so things are changing. We got to understand.
Right.
But at the
right.
same time, this change, as far as I'm concerned, should basically identify itself or align itself with our education system.
Okay.
If you want change, make sure that that change talks to whether it be more productivity or whether it be more getting along, whether, you know what I'm saying? That right. whole 9 years. But we're not doing that in many ways. Mm-hmm. Is that yeah. a fair note?
Yeah.
Okay.
Should we be covering the two big sides to do with the presidential platform, yeah, the way yeah. Obama wants it, all mm-hmm. that? Is that something that we
well, should? But still, I'm thinking about one thing, we'll do this at maybe another piece, but the whole idea was to try to get them to have this discussion.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
With the major parties.
All right.
To talk, just like we're talking right now.
Okay.
They should be talking about this issue. They may be doing it. Or better yet, to let the public know that they should be doing the same thing. And if they've got concerns, just like we were talking this to John or whatever, mm-hmm. they can invite folks over and talk about it. Mm-hmm. There's nothing wrong with that.
Okay.
But we've got to get something in place, you know, right. especially from the standpoint, who should carry a concealed weapon, and that person should there should be some justification for it or some real reason. I mean, I know John, and I know he's a solid guy, you know, and we've been known for quite some time, but the bottom line is that there are some people really shouldn't have any guns.
Well, they've had cases where they say you have to have a reason. Now, why do you have to have a reason?
Do they spell that out?
Oh, some places, yeah.
And do we spell that out here in Multnomah County?
No, because Oregon is a shall issue state. California is a.
So if you got the money and you got the record, you cool.
It doesn't cost that much, and if you're clean, you can do it.
That's what I'm saying, but yeah. that doesn't necessarily state that you won't break the law.
Well,
if you're clean.
That's true. I mean, look at Bernie Madoff, see? But in California, as I understand it, there's only two or three counties that issue. But in San Francisco County, one of the most restrictive, Dianne Feinstein, anti-gun
she's
queen.
She's a congressperson, right?
She is a senator, and senator. She has a concealed handgun license.
She has a concealed handgun.
Oh, yeah. But she doesn't want you to have one.
That sounds normal.
Yeah, well, I mean, you know, you see the lady publicly out there, and people, she probably gets a lot of calls, right?
Well, allowed to burn your microphone. Anyway, Donald Trump's got a concealed handgun license in New York, and you have to be somebody special in New York to, and have money. In fact, New York City does not recognize outside commissions or permits. In fact, a friend of mine, he was a Multnomah County jailer, and he went to get some guy out of a New York jail, and they had to fly into New Jersey. They left their guns in New Jersey Police Department, went across a river, picked the guy up, come back into New Jersey, retrieved their firearms, and got on a plane and come back. Because they, in New York City, the deal is, it's the city police officers and the counties and the state police and the feds, nobody else.
The only one that has guns.
Yeah. Legally.
Right.
And, oh, yeah, and carry.
And they had guns all over the place.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
They had guns all over the place. Well, look, we got about another good 10 minutes. And hopefully, did we get our point across, Richard, do you think?
Yeah, I just...
Let me talk about a couple other things, maybe.
Yeah, is there some big thing about which what Trump wants or what Hillary wants or Obama in regard to these guns? Is that anything that we should be
What about
covering?
That Dallas deal?
The Dallas piece, the guy was shot?
You remember what we talked about earlier?
What was that now?
That young, the ex-soldier that did the shooting in Dallas.
Right. Okay. Go on. Yeah.
Anyway, the U.S. military is in a process of getting rid of people, and so here's a young guy that was in and was forced out. Now, supposedly some woman was against him or something like that, and the deal is they know that. If they want you out, they can make a charge against you, and you're in real trouble. So I think this young guy was given a choice that you can fight this in a courts martial, and we'll give you a dishonorable discharge, and you'll lose all of your GI benefits. Or you can sign out, and we'll give you a general discharge, and you'll still have your GI benefits. Now, look at the general population of Americans of African ancestry is about 12 or 13%. The military is about 20%. Why? Because it's a better deal. You're looking at a young guy, says, also he's in the Army Reserve, he's doing some neat things, you know, all of a sudden he's successful, and the main thing in the military, Bruce will attest to this, is performance is the main thing.
Yeah.
And the deal is, he got cheated. And it probably played on his mind and worked against him, and that's probably what triggered it off.
That's the young black African American that, that shot the five police officers, you know, during that particular time. And in fact, his mother sort of hinted that to a certain degree. It's one of the deals where she basically said, he said that it wasn't what he thought it was going to be or something of that nature. And naturally, he's not here to defend himself or talk to the issue. And I thought that was a kind of interesting piece.
But they did talk about there was a tiff of some sort with some woman, and that triggered it. See?
Right. It's so easy to say, well, somebody raped me, or this, that, and the other. You know what I'm saying?
And it's his word against hers, and the deal is they don't check on it. They're in a big hurry to dump people out, and he got dumped out. And you know, being in the military, you know, active guard or reserve is really interesting. You know?
Yeah, it is. Oh yeah.
I mean, he was. That soldier, he was in defense of our country.
Yeah.
And you seen a picture of him. He was a sharp trooper.
Yeah, he was.
Okay.
He looked good.
It's kind of funny.
Yeah, we got about 6 minutes. And again, just to maybe recap a little bit about this piece. We've been talking.
Okay.
We've been talking about maybe adding the whole issue of weapons, firearms, and whatever to the platform that's being discussed now in this issue. And after that, that was a very horrific thing on both sides of the aisle on that shooting and whatever. And you know, it's really sad that we have to go through that in order just to get to the point to discuss to something that had we been discussing it and we'd taken care of some of those issues beforehand, that might not have happened. You know what I mean? But the fact of the matter is it did happen.
Yeah.
And so hopefully these young people, as far as I'm concerned, didn't die in vain on both sides of the aisle. And so hopefully now we can maybe sit down and seriously talk about whatever it is, whether it be reform, whatever, community, police, anything. But we got to put a handle on this thing. Very, very important. So for you, the viewing public, hey, spend some time. Get to your neighbors. Sit down and have a discussion. And if anything, maybe just stop and talk to a police officer and ask them the question. Why are you a police officer? How do you feel about this whole piece? I mean, what's all about? Have I done anything wrong? What do you think about community policing? You know, this, that, and the other. And better yet, why aren't we, at one point in time, when we had career day in the schools, the police was part of that. You know, they had all kinds of trades. We don't have those in the schools anymore for a career day.
Career day's coming up. It's the 27th.
On where?
Of this month.
Of what? Which who? Which schools? Which schools?
Sign the truth.
No, career. Careers.
I'm on career.
Oh, yeah, we'll talk about that subject next time. No problem.
Talk about,
we got that. That's another good day for John, too. He likes that. But anyway, but the whole idea is that we just have to have discussions on it. And we need to make sure those upcoming groups get a better training insight of the whole issue of carrying weapons or this, that, and the other, because that's where we are. A lot of us didn't get that. Now, we may be more responsible, but what about these young people that are coming up today?
Well, I train them pretty good.
No, but I'm just saying, just like you mentioned about the young fella that was in the military, had a career in this, that, and the other, and something happened to him.
Yeah.
And he started shooting. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
And so we don't need that.
Well, one of the things that
the race issue came up again.
Yeah, is economic opportunity. Our schools don't have vocational education.
Yeah, that's a good point.
Those kids come out and, you know, they can't handle tools, and that's a horrible thing. And that's why every so often they talk about pumping your own gas, and I says, you don't want that because 20,000 jobs would disappear in this state.
Yeah, but like I said, we got to really take care of this weapon situation. Because I've seen people with good jobs and this, that, and the other. Next thing you know, they come back to job and shoot up everybody.
That's right. So it's crazy. That's what happens.
Yeah, exactly. And then that, some people feel far safer. But I'm going to get me a concealed weapon permit because now I feel safer. You got me? Okay. And that should not be the cause. A person shouldn't have to be walked, just to get out of his house to feel safe. He has to have a gun.
Okay, that's right.
No, he should be able to walk the street like anything else.
Right.
And he's got law enforcement officers there if he needs to, whatever, whether it be a dispute of one wife, all kinds of deals. But right now, we're getting to the point now, it's just, and I will say that, not in defense of officers, but now if he knows that everybody's carrying, what's the first thing he's going
to
do?
Pull his out first. Go get your own carry.
You know, when you come out, boom, wait a minute. You sit right there, get on the ground, put your hand on. I mean, you know, just. It just don't make any sense. You got me?
Well, it's a matter of mutual respect. You know.
Well, I know. I understand. So you're getting it.
Maybe we should have this Marshman come on here.
Which one? The new chief?
Yeah.
Right. Yeah, that's a very. Now again, that's another interesting subject. I mean.
Yeah, that's a whole different deal.
It's a whole different ball game. You know what I mean? The guy's gonna. He's the new chief. I really would like for him to come, and you need to spend a little bit more time talking to. What he's going to do, and et cetera, et cetera. And talk about the issues that John.
I interviewed the chief a couple years ago, the one that was here.
You got about 15 seconds. Go on, do your job for close for this for the first one. Go on, you can go on close. Thank you very much, Richard.
Okay, I guess we're going to break now. So if you have the times for replay times, that'd be go ahead and put them up.
Okay, right.
There they are. And it's not as many, it's only two. It's the main one.
Okay, here we go. Look like we're on here. Again, this is supposed to be producer's row, if you will. But the bottom line is that we're honored again to be on as providing the guest and the subject for this particular hour. I think you'll enjoy this. I'm Bruce Broussard with the Oregon Voters Digest. And again, it'll probably it'll appear on my YouTube segment. And I think it'll be good. And so welcome. And my guest tonight, again, it was almost a continuation of the last show, but we're going to be talking about police work. Police, one, from a national perspective, and maybe react to some of the things that were happening from a national perspective, and then talk locally.
Sure.
And we've been spending quite a bit of time on Oregon Voters Digest talking locally, and that's basically where my guests are. We happen to have a former policeman here, Don DuPays. And Don's been on Oregon Voters Digest. We've been really discussing this issue, and I think we've been having some real good discussions, and I'm sure that the viewing public has been benefiting as a result of that, and we really benefited that. And just to show you how much of a benefit we've benefited, Don has written a book. Yeah, here's his right here, Behind the Badge in River City. This is the second edition. It's a very neat edition. Again, Behind the Badge in River City. We'll have a Portland Police memoir, and we'll have Don spend some time in terms of. I want him to spend some time and talk again for the benefit of the audience out here today. What was his rationale for doing such a fine piece? And it's a very easy read. He may even share with you about some of the folks you know. I mean, he's from here. It's beat. If there was a community policing, there it is. And then all you have to do is pick it up and you'll understand where I'm coming from. Mm-hmm. He knew the people in his beat.
Yes.
I mean, he was the old time. If that was community policing, there was community policing. Unlike today, it's a different ballgame. So we're trying to educate the public as a whole as to what we may want to really look at seriously when we start talking about the whole issue of community policing. We need to let you know what was, as far as I'm concerned, and then what we're trying to do today. And so we're sharing that. And we're not trying to counter anybody. The fact of the matter is, we're not sitting at the table.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. So anyway, got done. And then we have his wife, Teresa DuPays. And she, again, is an artist in her own right. And she's a writer, too. Besides being one of the major editors of Don's book, she has her own piece here, Blue River, because you can see, I mean, I go back to these, Reverie in Smoke, and she has a number of poems and whatever, and in this publication, it's a beautiful piece.
The introduction was written by Dan Raphael.
Dan Raphael.
Well-known poet.
Interesting.
In Portland.
But you also did another piece with another.
J.D. Chandler,
yeah. Who was kind of like in the same arena of police and this, that, and the other. Mm-hmm. I thought that was
crime
a good
history.
Piece. Crime history.
Yeah.
That was really good.
Yeah.
So Teresa has been, again, on the show often, and again, she's been part of this duo, this trio, if you will, the three musketeers, so to speak. But the bottom line. So what we're going to do is that I'm going to go down and sort of like give the lead to Teresa. I've asked her to try to, again, from the editor that she is, to come up with some of the questions that we may want to throw out on the table and have discussion. Don's probably doing most of the talking, but we're going to talk and probably respond
mm-hmm.
from the standpoint of
yeah.
a citizen's kind of a
mm-hmm.
situation, how we relate it to the whole issue
yeah.
of what the things that have been happening, and police.
Don has a lot of opinions about police work, and he's the resident expert here. But we, I made some little notes here, you know. We are concerned about the fact that we have a new police chief that has a pretty complicated past with his stepson and other issues.
We're talking about the new Mike Marshman.
Yeah.
Now he's an interim chief right now.
I think
yes.
so, yes.
Because you got Ted Wheeler coming in, the
Ted
new mayor.
Ted Wheeler wants to.
And he wants to go out and search.
Right, out of state.
If you're going to talk about community policing, I mean,
mm-hmm.
you got to. That's, you know, it just makes, well, anyway, I'm going to get in that discussion.
Yeah, it's a difficult situation.
It's a very
because
difficult
a lot
thing.
Of people don't feel that that Ted Wheeler should go out of state and search for a new police chief. I don't, personally. I know Don doesn't. There are some people I've talked to, a couple of people that have contact with police officers and or are married to them who have said they don't really think that there's anyone in Portland that could do the job because
mm-hmm.
there's so many issues with current Portland police officers and issues of corruption and issues of lack of honesty
mm-hmm.
and I think we definitely saw that with Larry O'Day.
Mm-hmm.
He's not only destroyed his own career and basically retired in disgrace, but he's taken several people with him. So,
but he's given us the opportunity for the discussion.
Yes, he has.
As far as we, I mean, I'm saying, maybe this might be the right time, if you will, to pull from the area because of that incident.
What I've heard, he's a really nice guy, but the fact is he did lie, and because of his lies, several of his closest associates also lied.
Associate chiefs.
Yeah,
assistant chiefs. Been picked. One of those guys could have been picked.
Yeah. Mike Krebs, Kevin Modica, Bob Day, and Donna Henderson.
And Modica was the only African-American that was part of that trio piece.
Yeah.
I mean, being groomed, if you will, the possibility of picking up chiefs sometime, whatever. So I think the concept was great, because again, you talk about folks that were there, they came through the ranks and whatever, and you know, well, anyway, okay?
Yeah.
So Don, what do you think?
Well, the police department now.
Excuse me, but before you do that, just for the benefit, like I said, talk a little bit about your book. Tell them who Don
is. Well, the reason
and you're preaching and all that.
I was a Portland police officer here from 1961 to 1978. I was on the street here in Portland until 1967. So I spent 6 years working albina, both as a patrol officer from North Precinct and as a traffic cop.
Pull your head up a little bit. You want to
as
see
a traffic cop.
There you go. Thank you, sir. Are you a good man?
So I have a lot of experience with what went on back in the 60s, which is admittedly a completely different time.
Yeah.
But there was still a lot of corruption. And that's what I wanted to point out, both the good people that I work with, and there were a lot of them, and the bad apples who either died off. You know, Bruce, I've outlived most of them.
I got you. Okay.
I've outlived most of them. So there are a few co-conspirators still out there collecting retirement checks. But that's what the book was about.
But
about
during that time, that was legal, right?
What was legal? Just about everything.
That was just the way we lived.
Just about everything was legal.
I think one of the things people often presume is that Portland was a much safer place in the 60s, or that North and Northeast Portland was as safe in the 60s as it is today. That's something people need to really rethink, because it wasn't. Portland was a very different city, and North and Northeast Portland was very segregated, and it was dangerous for white people to be over there, according to Don.
C.W. Jensen was talking about some event that was going on North Mississippi Street and how wonderful it was.
He's a foreign policeman.
He's a former policeman.
Okay.
And he related the same thing about the old days that I remember, when Mississippi Street was a very dangerous place. Mm-hmm. White people didn't dare walk down there, especially at night. It just wasn't an area that you wanted to be in. Some other friends of mine have had a wonderful time lately in Dawson Park. Dawson Park has been redone.
Mm-hmm.
It used to be also a very dangerous place with dope shooters and shooters and prostitution. It wasn't a place for families.
Yeah.
So this whole area has changed.
Yeah.
It's not the same place. It's not the same city.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But some of the same problems exist, and especially with the police department.
Mm-hmm.
So if we can get down to what's wrong with the police department now, that's what we can talk about. Because the chief has successfully destroyed himself, and three or four other assistant chiefs with what they do wrong is they do the first thing that they learn in the police job is lie.
Mm.
And I'm sorry to say that, but that's the first thing you learn. Yes.
Why was
you
that
lie
so?
On a police
why?
Report?
Why? Why is that?
Because that's just the way it is. It's a story in my book about a guy that my coach and I arrested when I was a young policeman still on probation. He was yelling up on a porch. My partner, my coach, got tired of listening to him yelling, and he wouldn't go in the house. Went up on the porch, grabbed him by the neck, drug him down on the street, stuffed him in the police car, and arrested him for being drunk on the street. And when I questioned that after the guy had been sent to jail, he says, well, we have a job to do, and law or no law, we solve the problems.
But he didn't shoot him.
But the whole process was a lie.
Okay.
And that's one of my first weeks on the police department, is how you learn to embellish on your police report so that it looks best for you. So the whole concept of lying just goes right on up, and here we got a chief of police and deputy chiefs who are lying about their involvement in shooting squirrels.
Right.
Who shoots squirrels?
Yeah, they were out hunting.
Hunting squirrels.
I mean, unless they make squirrel stew, you know. I can't imagine eating squirrels.
So they've got themselves all messed up because they lost out.
Mm-hmm.
They forgot what they signed on to do.
Mm-hmm.
Swear the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth.
Mm-hmm.
And they got themselves.
Mm-hmm.
They cost themselves. I don't think that they should be allowed to retire, especially O'Day. I think O'Day should be decertified by the Bureau of Police Standards and Training so that he has to figure out how to make a living. Mm-hmm. You know, they shouldn't be able to lie, get screwed up like this, and then take a nice fat retirement check home too. Mm-hmm. Something wrong with that. It galls me.
I think another issue that we really need to discuss is the issue of alcoholism, because mm-hmm. I mean, from what I've read, O'Day was so visibly intoxicated that he couldn't talk very well. His words were slurred. He was having a hard time, you know, ambulating. I mean, there's an issue with police officers, and it needs to be addressed. And we've seen it recently in the last, you know, 10 years. So many Portland police officers having an issue with alcohol to self-medicate, and that's unfortunate.
Well, that whole stress issue.
That's part of the, has been, part of the
has
stress.
Has
yeah.
developed, yeah. you know, and through the years, and it's adding on every
yeah.
day.
Yeah.
You got, you see what I'm saying? Yeah. I mean, now with the, that's what we talked about in this last show. Mm-hmm. I mean, the fact of the matter is, everybody's armed. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, and yeah, folks who shouldn't
yeah.
be
yeah.
Are armed, and that's tough.
Yeah.
So well,
yeah.
now we got supposedly law enforcement officers.
Mm-hmm.
You know, how do they go about enforcing?
Yeah. yeah.
With that,
yeah.
with this kind of mentality, Don, you got any thoughts on
that? Well, it's completely different. When I was on the street, I didn't let anybody have a gun but me,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I was serious about that. And now it's completely different. Anybody can have a gun. So I don't know how you approach people, but certainly with a lot more caution.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
yeah.
I don't know if their records, if they have availability of whether a person has a permit to carry or not, mm-hmm. as soon as they get on the radio, or they're just showing up at the car. Mm-hmm. You know, and getting shot. It's so.
During the time you're on foot, if you don't mind my asking this question, did you shoot anybody? Have
no.
you shot anybody?
No, I never
you
did.
Never did.
I was lucky.
He shot at.
I was very
one
lucky.
Person, but it didn't. He didn't get him.
I shot
Willie
at,
Nelson.
I shot
the
at
boxer.
Willie Nelson, after he pulled a knife on me and yeah. tried to gut me.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I shot at him, and fortunate for both of us, I missed him.
Okay.
I got. A bullet hole right yeah. here in his coat.
Yeah.
When the detectives found him the next day, they found him with a bullet hole in his coat. So that's how close we both came to being sorry.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
But during that particular time you were there, were there many shootings from policemen?
No. But there were some shootings. I had a partner, Fred Brock, who shot a burglar in the back. I happened to be on my day off, fortunately for me. A burglar down on Mississippi Street that broke out of the glass door of a furniture store, took off running down the street. Fred said, "Stop or I'll shoot." He didn't stop. Fred shot him in the back. He dropped a 1D and kept going and got lost in the dark. He showed up at Emmanuel Hospital about an hour later with a bullet hole in his back, but he didn't die.
But he wasn't yeah. shot 10 or 20 times.
Right.
No, he wasn't.
Right.
You know why? Because we had six shooters.
Six shooters?
Six shooters. We went to work.
That's all in one chamber, or was that?
Oh, no, we had six shooters. We had six in the gun, and six backup.
Mm-hmm.
We went to work with 12 rounds. Now they go to work with a gun loaded with 14 rounds and two or three extra ammunition. That's one of the problems. You know, we need to discuss that too.
Hmm.
Well, that's an issue that has to do with the modern age.
Yeah.
You know, and they can't. Police officers aren't going to go back to six shooters. Mm-hmm. That would not be wise.
I'm not saying they should.
No.
And the other issue is that there's three times as many people in Portland now as there were in the 60s, mm-hmm. and so it's just a bigger, more congested city mm-hmm. with more mm-hmm. social ills and just all the problems that go with more congestion.
So we've got a lame duck mayor and lame duck chiefs.
Mm-hmm.
So it doesn't really make any difference what these guys do. They're either going to be fired or retired. They're not going to be around. So along comes Ted Wheeler. I don't know how he's going to deal with the police culture. I don't know him well enough
yeah.
to know. How
yeah.
is he going to deal with this entrenched unionized
and our,
police culture?
Our
so.
Feeling is he doesn't have any experience and or background in law enforcement. Mm-hmm. He's going to need a lot of advice. He's going to need a lot of help because this is not something that comes naturally to him. Does he have any background in it? Mm-hmm. I don't believe so.
I don't think he's probably
and
military.
If he goes out and tries to get a police chief out of state, we're going to have all kinds of problems.
Mm-hmm.
The rank and file are not going to like it. We've got people in Portland. We've got
mm-hmm.
people in Portland that can do that job.
Mm-hmm.
We don't need a police chief from out of state. We don't need another croaker.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Croker came from LA and he instituted a lot of militaristic changes in the Portland Police Bureau that a lot of people were not happy with.
That's the way LA was, though.
Yeah.
That's the way LA was.
You know, so
that's what you
all,
get.
We all creatures of our exposure.
That's what you get. Yeah.
But it creates a. It creates a feeling of unease with the general population, with citizens, when they see that police officers are becoming more and more militaristic. It's frightening.
The citizens are justifiably outraged because it seems like it's just one police outrage after another.
Yeah. It's getting embarrassing.
Here's Portland, Oregon, and we got a big mess with all of our top brass in the police.
Yeah.
How are the citizens supposed to respect policemen?
It's getting pretty embarrassing. Yeah.
Well, you know, I might make note to the viewing public that, you know, as you know, we ran for mayor.
Yes, we did.
We ran for mayor, and the whole purpose was to educate and inform. Mm-hmm. And we had a number of shows, and in fact, both Charlie Hill, city mayor, was invited numerous times.
Yes.
And he was on the show before when he was running for mayor.
Both of them were.
Yeah, Charlie Hale's when he was running against Jefferson Smith.
Exactly, he was on and with Jefferson and whatever.
But now he's too busy.
That's right. And then here's Ted, who felt, well, he didn't come on the show, but the whole idea was that we were talking about, the idea was to educate him and inform him. I knew he was lacking in this situation.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, that's one of the reasons why we ran.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, because no one else had the background that we had, so to speak. Not to say that other folks had something to contribute, but we were talking about a specific subject, which is very of major concern to our city and our well-being in aspect of it. So again, the same opportunity comes. Again, with Ted Willer, who's going to be the next mayor, we'd like to invite him on to the show.
Absolutely.
And just talk with him and ask him his rationale for wanting to go out.
Because, right.
And don't do it at the last minute because it's not going to work.
Yeah.
What folks don't understand is that going outside looking for a chief is the wrong thing to do because we need local.
Yeah.
We need local. We don't need somebody from Baltimore who's already probably in trouble. Looking for a chief's job somewhere on the West Coast where they can hide out.
Right.
No, we don't want to do that. And they also don't realize that the mayor who appoints the chief of police doesn't have to take a captain. I mean, if there are those in the Bureau, and I've heard this, that there's nobody in there qualified to be the chief of police, I don't believe that because I believe if you look down the ranks far enough, you'll find somebody. The precedent for that was Lieutenant Ron Still, who I have problems with. But anyway, he was a lieutenant when he was appointed chief of police. You can, if you're looking for somebody with integrity, go down and find a street sergeant, somebody who's been there for 25 years and knows what's going on.
Right.
They don't have to be a captain, a lieutenant. They just need to look for a man with integrity. And not worry about how many stripes and bars he has. They look for integrity because without any integrity, you know, they're all screwed up.
You know, I thought about the point. Again, I was thinking along that same line, you know, from the standpoint of within, and the idea of going down back with the folks that are on the street, on the beat aspect of it, because the officers, in most cases, they've been on the street, but they're in an administrative position.
That's right.
Yeah. So the idea to identify with the troops, someone who's been there with the troops.
You want somebody
more current, if you will.
You want somebody who hasn't been a whiz at taking
tests. That's right.
Yeah. And that's how a lot of these guys get to be captain. They were never really good police officers, but really good test takers.
Yes.
So I want a good police officer who maybe flunked a couple of tests, who has the street creds.
Right.
Let me point this out too. I wrote this article about integrity in policing some years ago, but in here, I talk about the Department of Bureau of Police Standards and Training, who certifies all these cops, says, yes, you can be a policeman now, and gives them a certificate and a badge number. But they ask them to honor this thing here. It says, on my honor, I will never betray my badge, my integrity, or my character, or the public trust. I will always have the courage to hold myself and others accountable for our actions. I will always uphold the Constitution, my community, and the agency I serve.
Wow.
What we see here is total failure in the top leadership of the police department. They threw this out the window.
Wow.
Lie, cheat, drunk.
Wow. Well, what are we going to do?
I don't know what we're going to do. Well, I'm going to go down and find a sergeant who's got some street creds and talk to Wheeler about it. That's what we need to do.
Yeah.
Is find somebody who can be the chief of police, color, and they don't need to recruit out of state. They need to do police recruiting here in Portland. They ought to, in my opinion, take all the black officers and go to the colleges around here and recruit. Take all of the gay officers and go around to these colleges and schools and recruit. The message we need to be talking to local people, there's a lot of guys that want to be policemen. Mm-hmm. I've seen them in school.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
We are you. You are us. Mm-hmm. We are community. Come mm-hmm. join mm-hmm. us. Be policemen with us. Mm-hmm. Be us. We are you.
Mm-hmm.
That's the message I have. That's how I would recruit new policemen. Mm-hmm.
Well, you know, again, along that same line, just like when you had a beat, you knew your beat, and the people
yeah.
knew you.
Yeah, yeah.
That's
yeah.
community policing. I mean, you didn't have to have that's good. You didn't have to have two people driving in the car. I mean, yeah. you can almost drive by. I remember Harry was the same boat. Remember little Harry Jackson?
Yeah, I didn't know Harry.
Harry was a little short. He was short and whatever, but we had to work to get him on the force. Mm-hmm. But the reason why he was so successful, he was from the community.
Right, sure. And he knew everybody.
And he was an African American, and he
right.
knew everyone.
Yeah.
And then from the recruiting standpoint, he recruited his sister and his son to be a recruit, be a policeman.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Not the nepotism aspect of it, but the fact
right.
of it is,
yeah.
it's just the same value system that you're talking about. You know, you have to know what your terrain looks like. And it takes time, and you got to be working with people, being able to work with, if you will, people. Right?
The controversy between community policing and profiling.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, talk to me.
Okay. I'm the street cop, I'm in your district, and it's my job to protect you.
Right.
Okay. I can't protect you if I don't know who's here.
Right.
So if I see a car that I've never seen before, I'm going to stop it.
And say hi.
Because, hey, I'm going to say hi. I'm the local officer around here.
There you go.
How are you?
Yes.
What are you doing?
Yes.
Where do you live?
Yes.
Why are you here?
Yes.
Is that profiling? Probably.
But
is
at
it
night,
good
you
police work?
But basically, you're doing the night, the major stop.
Yes, I was at night.
Yes,
I work
right.
always at night.
Major.
But in order to protect the citizens, you have to know who's out there.
Mm-hmm.
I had a file in the back, a little 3x5 card file, mugshots. I knew who was in my district. If a car came by that I didn't know, I found out who they were. I was the local cop. I was the sheriff. And I think it was much better in those days. The other thing that we need to address is two-man cars.
Yeah.
These cops that are getting into trouble, that are getting beat up, that are getting assaulted by these guys who jump out of the car, there's only one of them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I can never remember, maybe only once or twice, when two of us couldn't handle something.
Right.
That was like a melee in front of a tavern or something. But the problem is the police department is not correctly organized now for the work they need to do.
Mm.
I've talked about the traffic division before. There are 24 motorcycle officers. That's 12 two-man cars back out on the street.
Wow.
There's probably 10 or 12 cops working in internal affairs. That's another 4 or 5 two-man cars back out on the street.
Mm.
It's not so much that we don't have enough policemen, and we certainly do need more,
right.
but the ones we got are too specialized.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That doesn't mean that traffic tickets won't be written. I wrote lots of traffic tickets when I was working Prowl. You see, it's just you're just more of a generalist. You take everything from the traffic ticket to the fender bender to the homicide.
Mm-hmm.
You'll call the detectives for the homicide, but you're the unit. You're on the street. There's two of you. And boy, there needs to be two.
Well, tell me this about that whole piece about the two. You know, you did community policing center. What do you think about this whole education piece where you have to have a degree now to be a cop?
Well,
what do you think about that?
It helps, I think, but it's not necessary.
Better educated policemen are, of course, wonderful, but if you don't have common sense, your college degree isn't going to do you any good. And they don't teach college.
They don't teach common sense.
No,
that's right. Yeah. That's right.
So if you don't have common sense, I don't care if you're a master's degree, you're stupid.
They don't know.
There's
got to be people-oriented.
You got to be people-oriented,
Also another issue currently with law enforcement, and that is that in the last 30 years, there's been less reliance on physical combat, hand-to-hand combat, and more reliance on technology, you know, stun guns, mace, things like that.
Mm-hmm.
Don and I have talked about this, and I talked about it with a couple of other police officers, too. When you take away a police officer's ability to get someone under control, but like, for example, using the chokehold. The chokehold, Don used the chokehold hundreds of times. He worked the streets, and he never killed anybody. When you take those kinds of tools away from an officer, then you put them in a corner, and they're only, you know, they're going to have to rely more on tools and their gun, you know. So there's a lot of old time officers criticize the current police bureau because current officers, not only in Portland but everywhere in, you know, LA and New York and California, Chicago, seem to have less ability to overpower a criminal or an offender using hand-to-hand combat. And I think we just need to go back to some of the older way, the old ways that have been proven successful, you know. And then you have instances of, I think there's 550 or 600 people that have died from tasers.
Tasers
because it interferes with a person's electrical, you know, with their, you know.
And we're all different.
Yeah. And some people have weak hearts, and I mean, that's unacceptable too. So it's just, we're at a crisis right now in this country with law enforcement. I can't remember a time when law enforcement officers have not been more hated. And of course, the situation in Dallas, what a tragedy, what an absolute tragedy. You know, that accomplished nothing. It's polarized this country. Mm-hmm. It's contributing to this feeling of black and white being against each other. And it's really tragic. It's just really, really sad.
Mm. So. Let me make another point in regards to what we're doing here. And we'd suggest that you get your neighbors and have discussions about this situation.
Yeah.
In fact, call up the department and have a policeman come to your home and get the neighbors together and chat, just like we're doing.
Mm-hmm.
Just like we're doing. And ask those questions and get those feelings out there. And, because they are law enforcement officers to protect you, really, the public.
Yeah.
And we got this whole issue with the firearms, because in that last show that I did, and I'll just make the point, and that's what I was asking this John Sweeney guy, was that the NRA has basically gotten everybody armed.
Yeah.
And I'd like to get them to be a part of the platform while they're having the national platform to talk about this issue, because they're an important entity that's here, because, you know, you're promoting the guns, but there's a lot of other things. I was going to ask you about that, Don, about that whole piece. There were two shootings that were very horrific, if you will. We had the one young cop that shot the young man point blank, so to speak.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You know, and the guy supposedly had asked him, the cop asked him, the guy said, look, I got a gun and, you know, I got a permit for it. He said, well, give me the license. By the time he reached for the license, the guy, bam.
Yeah. Yeah. Philandro Castile.
Yeah. What do you think about that? What happened? What was your view about that piece?
Well, the policeman shot when he shouldn't have.
Mm-hmm. We don't really have access
but still, we got something of this.
Yeah.
And that's what we have.
You got a white policeman and you got a black man reaching for something. That's just not going to be good.
I mean, just announcing the fact, he'd been, in all due respect, kind of like in this. No. It shouldn't have said anything about the gun, wouldn't you think?
Yeah.
What I read on the internet was that 2 days before, a man fitting his description, Philandro Castile, had been wanted for armed robbery. But that's, you know, fitting his description. I mean, what's that?
Yeah.
25
yeah.
years old, 30 years old, black man, young black man.
Yeah.
That
yeah.
could be anyone.
Yeah.
It's a tragedy. And I saw the video. I saw part of the video. There's still a lot of information that's not concrete yet, but that we don't understand.
Now, the other one, what I didn't understand was the big guy. I know the big guy,
mm-hmm. yeah.
But I saw two big guys.
Yeah.
And I'm trying to figure out. First off, what did he say
to
that
the guy
terrible.
To just run and tackle him? I mean, just tackle him and just bang. And you got two guys on one guy.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm a small guy. And I know how to, you know.
I did see that video, and that was weird.
That was weird. But it's the discussion. That's why we have it. And again, it was another black guy.
Yeah. Right. And he appeared to be unarmed, and he was on his back,
exactly.
and the two officers were on
exactly.
him, and the one officer shot him point blank.
Exactly.
It's just.
I don't know. I don't understand that.
It wasn't no robbing no bank. It was, he's selling videos on the corner.
No.
And I'm trying to figure out what.
Yeah. Well, it's just what happened. I mean, what viewers saw in that video is that he was flat on his back with two cops on him. And then the one cop shot him point blank. He didn't appear to be armed. I mean, That's just.
And if we didn't have the videos,
right,
we wouldn't have. We wouldn't be right. talking about discussion.
Exactly.
It'd just be. Well, I don't want to say too dead.
Everything now that everybody has a camera,
yeah.
it's a different world.
Yeah, it's a whole different world.
It's a different world. The police are being videotaped all the time.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
I don't think.
And they're being asked to video.
Yeah.
Sometimes it might be better for them to get their own videos, wear the cams, so at least you have.
And
your
they
argument.
Do, and then they lie.
They
I mean, there's. I was reading this afternoon about a case. A white officer was on the dash cam. Mm-hmm. He wrote a false report, and he's arrested now because he tried to frame a black man for a crime he didn't commit, and then. He wrote a false report, and then the dash cam proved that he was lying. And so he's in prison now. He's serving 5 years.
Wow.
And the black man was exonerated, and he's free. But it's like these things are coming out now because when Don was a cop, you could be a cop, and you could falsify reports regularly. Now, if you falsify a report and your actions are contradicted by what's on the dash cam, you know, then you're held accountable.
But they don't promote incarceration of officers. No. But now it's suddenly getting ready to do it. Fair?
Yeah, fair.
Well,
they're getting ready to do that now, right?
Yeah.
That's
the
whole idea of the cam and all this, that, and the other. There's got to be a better way.
I don't think that all officers are getting away with murder because, the police chief in Dallas, I mean, he transformed that whole area, and he had to fire 70 police officers. And I think there was the year, there was like over 150 complaints with excessive force, and a couple of years ago there were like 13 or 14. He fired 70 cops, and they were probably, I'm sure that most of them were white, and they probably had multiple counts of excessive force in their personnel files.
But he was black.
And he fired.
The chief was black.
He cleaned up. He cleaned up that town.
Some of those guys quit. Some of those guys quit because he was black.
Yeah, which is ridiculous.
And where are they now?
He's a wonderful guy.
Where are these 75 guys that got fired? They
another
cop jobs on my payroll.
That's right.
Yeah,
might be a few
years. That's hard though. I mean, when you get fired from one department, it's hard for a cop to just go and apply somewhere else because they want to know, well, why'd you get fired? I mean, that's difficult. But I did watch the memorial service, and Obama gave an absolutely amazing speech.
Awesome.
I just have to say that what he said was just heartfelt, and he's being criticized for that. I mean, it's like, come on. That speech was inspiring. It was about 45 minutes. Mm-hmm. I watched it, and I just thought, wow, everything he said was just perfect.
But you remember, in all due respect, that should be part of the training.
Mm-hmm.
That should be a training film. But at the same time, now check this out. It was shown on CNN, all the way through, and Fox. I normally put MSNBC with CNN, basically the same boat. But it wasn't shown on any of the commercial shows.
Yeah.
No commercial show. That's where it should have been.
You
can
see it on YouTube, though. I watched it on YouTube.
People don't have YouTube. Now, we're going to put it on our YouTube, and that's going to become a part of the show for Oregon Voters Digest.
Yeah.
And we're going to have a little piece on it. We'll do a put-together show, and then we'll talk it to it.
You know, Fred, the two-man car thing can stop a lot of this stuff because Mike Brown would have never happened if he'd had backup.
Yeah.
And he's quoted as saying, if I'd have just had a few more minutes,
I'd
have just had a few more seconds
for
backup to show up,
it
wouldn't have happened that way. Two-man cars are absolutely essential. Make me the chief of police today, and there'll be two-man cars on the street tomorrow.
Well, we were going to do that. I was going to do that.
I'm telling you.
Unfortunately, they didn't like the idea of my being mayor. I don't know what to...
You did pretty good.
Well, no, I mean, I think...
We still need to have...
I get enough pills.
Mr. Wheeler... come here, if you will.
We'll help him
sit
out.
Sit down.
We'll help him.
We'll help him.
And educate him about this whole piece.
Yeah.
But you have to understand, a lot of people are knocking on his doors wanting jobs.
Yeah. Well, the thing about
wanting jobs.
Yeah.
Look, I'm the right guy for you.
Yeah.
You know, then he gets in trouble. That's when he'll call you, Don. Mm-hmm.
The thing about Mike, thing about Ted Wheeler going out of state and looking for a chief of police is that it will result in even lower morale in the rank and file. Mm-hmm. Do we really want that? We've had so many scandals in the last 10 years. Do we really want Portland police officers to be even more depressed and disgusted with some chief of police from out of state that they don't know that's going to come in and institute a lot of changes that don't make sense to them?
Yeah.
Do we really want that? Ted Wheeler really needs to wise up.
Absolutely,
so,
I agree.
Yeah.
Wow, this is heavy piece. Now let's talk about this is our local piece, but from a national standpoint, do you think they're going to actually? Well, it looked like they were trying to, as far as the platform, the national platform with both of the presidential you got the Democrats, you got the Republicans, and you've got the Libertarian because they're part of the piece too, the three major ones aspect of it. You think that's going to be part of that platforms? Are they going to? You think that's going to be part of the platform? So,
reforming police. Oh, absolutely.
You think so?
Probably, yeah.
Okay.
Because
okay.
it's such a huge
Especially
issue right
with this
now.
Issue, yeah, right now,
yeah.
Right? Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
With the okay. the deaths and the police officers killed in Dallas, Philander Castile. The yeah, it's just huge. I think they will, yeah.
You know, they need to because this all started, I think, a long time ago with who's the guy in L.A. they beat up?
Rodney King.
It all started with Rodney King,
yeah.
when everybody could clearly see they beat the hell out of him.
Yeah.
And then they were
with
found not guilty of anything.
Yeah,
right.
with the camera. Yeah.
Right.
So,
yep.
so
yeah.
this has been going on and on and on for all these years now. The police are never held accountable in the eyes of the citizen. So finally, I think this the frustration has boiled over, and that's how Dallas happened.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
If you guys are never going to be held accountable, the downtrodden are going to hold you accountable.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And if they don't change, there's going to be more of this retaliation. You know, eventually the slave's going to get mad.
Yeah. Well, they are now.
And they get mad and they start killing their oppressors. I mean, this is nothing new. This is old history.
Yeah.
And that's what's happening now. If the police were held accountable each and every time, the citizen would say, oh, well, that's okay. He got what he deserved. Mm-hmm. Now I don't have to go out and kill him.
Mm-hmm.
See?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It's about accountability.
That's
if
right.
you don't have
what,
accountability, what, you're going to continue this. You're going to continue this mess. Mm-hmm.
What's really distressing to me is the way people divide racially when these things happen.
Mm-hmm.
Black people get so angry at the corruption and white police officers who seemingly don't get disciplined or terminated, you know, like in the case of Rodney King, because it really started with Rodney King.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it did.
And I mean, how many people died in the riots? 55 or something?
Yeah,
I mean, there was some god-awful amount of people. You know, black people were attacking white people, and white people were, it causes this racial divide, and it's getting really, really upsetting to see. There are a lot of black people that I've noticed in the last few months that absolutely hate white people. There are some black radicals that are calling for, you know, kill white people. I mean, that's distressing to hear because that's not what we need. We need unity. We need compassion for each other, you know, and police officers need to be held accountable when they do stupid things like this guy who shot Philander Castile.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You know, what was he thinking?
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean,
but like Don said, he was black with a gun.
Yeah.
And you know what I'm saying? Had he been white with a gun, it would have been a different story.
Unfortunately,
it would have been a different story.
Yeah, it would be a different story.
And so now we get, and then the other thing that is about this whole piece is that when I think about the Black Lives Matter, when you look at the groups that's marching, there are more whites than blacks.
That's true in a lot of cases.
People don't relate that.
Yeah.
See, you're talking about a lot of young folks
are
basically feeling the same deal.
Well, and in certain cities, I think there's more whites than blacks that are doing that are involved. Definitely
sure.
in Portland.
Well, right here in Portland,
yeah,
we got
Portland.
Teresa out there.
Yeah.
She's the kind of the lead person aspect of it. I mean,
she's a great speaker and a wonderful thinker and a good leader.
But again, they don't understand what she's doing.
Right.
And just looking at her black skin,
yeah.
You know, there are other folks, there are other Portlanders that are saying, hey, there's been some issues with reference to homeless. They were killed, but these were white guys too, aspect of it. So my point is that we got a whole new epidemic aspect of it. So we need to have the discussion.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you know, she's been on the show here.
Yeah.
You know, she's trying to, i.e., express herself along the line. And I have heard basically the same thing about some of the other folks, well, she's a maniac or this, that, and that.
Yeah.
She's not.
What you do is, Black Lives Matter is important.
Listen to what she has to, it is.
It is an important movement. Unfortunately, there's so many different sects of Black Lives Matter that have different values that go about their business differently. And there are some of them, I've seen some videos in Chicago and New York, where they're primarily black activists and they're very anti-white.
But that's a different culture.
Right. So that's the problem with the Black Lives Matter movement is that so many of the groups are very different from each other. There's no general
depending upon the area.
There's no general consensus.
But it
needs better leadership as far as I'm concerned. And if they want to do protests, you know, I took a class with Tom Hastings. He's a conflict resolution professor at PSU. And we studied a book by Gene Sharp, which is 198 Methods of Peaceful Protest. When they go on highways and close shit down, they don't accomplish anything. They just make people angry because they're trying to get home to their kids, they're trying to get home to feed their children, they're trying to take care of their elderly parents, they're trying to go to work, and they prevent them from doing that. So the Black Lives Matter movement is very important. It needs better leadership.
But think about this now. We think about this. Now, again, we've had a lot of White Lives Matter demonstrations. And nobody says anything. I mean, we have the major stuff out in this area. My point is that, I guess my point is that they see the people, you know, and then they try to make it a black and white thing, but the more black thing. But it's just people trying to find out what are they demonstrating for. It's a right. People, you know, the First Amendment say you got right to speak, right? That same situation. So the bottom line is that when I looked at a lot of times people say, well, Bruce, what about this Black Lives Matter? I said, no, it's American Lives Matter. It just happened to be black. That's the agenda today. You know what I mean? For that particular group. There's nothing wrong with
that. There's the whole idea that when people say all lives matter, they're diminishing. Diminishing Black Lives Matter, and that's true.
That's true.
You know, Black Lives Matter is a very specific movement. It's a very specific group, and I think it's a good group. And I think that Teresa Rayford is a really good spokesman for it here in Portland. I do think that it needs better leadership overall. They need to kind of learn how to demonstrate effectively, because closing shit down isn't effective. It doesn't. It just makes regular people angry, and I mean there have been instances of Black Lives Matter volunteers getting run over by cars. I mean, there have been assaults. There's too much violence associated with it when those protests, those demonstrations happen, and they close down highways. You know, people get angry. They're trying to get home to feed their kids, or they're trying to get to work. They can do other things. They can create other methods of protest that are more effective, but it requires more planning. But it is a very important movement, and I support it. I definitely do.
I think my main problem with Black Lives Matter is I don't see them out here on the street protesting when some black person kills a black gang member. I don't see that. Charles Barkley is on Facebook and interviewed, and he says, well, most black people I know are killed by black people. Well, he's right. And where is Black Lives Matter about that? You know, so that's a major problem.
Someone would take exception to Barkley. he's a different kind of
he's a different kind of
identity. Okay,
but he's right.
From the standpoint, let's extend that. We got education, we got jobs, and this, that, and the other. That's that part that I'm looking at. You got my point? It's so easy to be able to say, okay, fine. It's like anything. When a person says gang, automatically people identify it as black. They got white gangs, they got Asian gangs, they got the whole nine yards. But when you say gang, people automatically. And the media has helped develop that issue. Publishers, all kinds of stuff happens on that aspect. But now's the time for discussion. And that's what I'm saying. We're having a discussion here about this piece. We want you to hold those same questions that these discussions among yourselves. And then call these so-called folks that you've elected to office. And I'm talking about from Congress to federal. Call up Ron Wyden. And he's just another person that you elected to office, or Earl Blumenauer and whatever. They're elected by you. And if you got some concerns, you know, you need to tell them, because we're having those discussions now, sitting up there at the conventions, both on the R side and the D. We don't have that many congressmen from Oregon that are Republicans. We got one, Greg Walden, but you can still call him. You can still call him. And there's no such thing as we got a problem here. We got a problem that we got to hopefully talk about. And now's the time to do it. Fair? Now's the time to do it. So hopefully Willie is hearing what we're saying. Hey man, come on over and we'll have this discussion. You got Don here. We can even get CJ to be a part of the little group.
CW.
CW. Sorry about that, CW. But anyway, he's out there. You know, he wants to talk. And he does, and he's been an officer, and he's been involved with police work.
He's very smart. He's got a lot of
very much so, very much so. So my point is that we've got some folks around that can sit at the table. Even myself, I'd like to talk about this stuff. I ran for office along that particular line, but the fact of the matter is, you're gonna have to talk to someone. Otherwise, don't call me after you get in all the trouble. Don't do that. You know what I'm saying? Cause please watch the people that knock on your door saying, look man, give me a couple of bucks and I'll be your consultant. No, get out to the public. The public is here. We're ready to help. It's not costing them anything. We want to make sure that we can walk down the street and have a cup of coffee and write down.
Yep.
One thing I want to say before we go, definitely want to say this, is if the listening audience hasn't seen the memorial speech by President Barack Obama,
yep.
I suggest that you all go to YouTube and look for that speech and listen to it. It's about 41 or 42 minutes long. Yep. It is inspirational. He acknowledges the corruption in police departments. He acknowledges that racism exists. He acknowledges that division is not what we need. We need unity. We need compassion for
everybody.
Each other.
He identified everybody.
Yes.
We're all responsible.
Right.
And it was
yeah.
it was a marvelous
it
speech.
It was.
We're going to have it on there, and Kate knows. We're going to go on and put that on now,
yeah.
if you will, and we'll put some caption behind it and get that out to everyone.
Yeah. Yeah.
It should
you
be.
Know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And hopefully the Oregonian and the Tribune will put that whole speech in their papers, you know, because Tribune is free.
Mm-hmm.
That would be neat. Put it on front page and let people read it and then ask them for comments. I mean, that what an opportunity. Yeah.
I was impressed that he did, that he, and everyone knows he wrote it. You know, he's a brilliant man. But I was so impressed with what he said, because it's really the first time he's ever been so supportive of law enforcement.
Mm-hmm.
And I really was really happy about that, because we need to support law enforcement. We need to support the police officers in our community to do their job and to feel safe and to not hate them, you know.
But people were listening.
Yeah.
That's why their support came. He might have had he might have said the same thing back when, but he didn't have that opportunity. The door opened because two black men died behind guns by police.
Yeah.
And okay, but so meaning that they didn't die in vain, and let's make sure we understand that. It was very horrific. I'm sorry their lives were taken on both sides of the aisle.
Yeah.
But the fact of the matter is, well, I'm talking about the futures now. What about our youth?
Mm-hmm.
What about these young folks that, like I said, we call them gang members? Are they getting their education?
Mm-hmm.
It's about the job, because if you don't eat, you're going to find somewhere to get you something to eat.
Yeah.
And I hate to put it that way, but that's the name of the game. It's about eating, right?
Yeah. It's about eating.
It's not about the money, it's about eating.
It's about eating.
If I don't have nothing, I'm going to go to your house and get it when you walk to go to job.
Yeah.
Right?
You're right.
That fair?
Yeah.
Okay, good. Well, look, we got about another 10 minutes. Anything else we want to maybe talk to real quick, like briefly?
Well, let's fix the police departments. Let's go back to two-man cars immediately.
Okay.
Let's take them out of the black, the intimidating uniforms, and put them back in blue uniforms.
That's
that
important.
Would be huge here in Portland.
I agree.
Let's put more people on the street and do less specialization.
Mm-hmm.
Do we really need a traffic department that does nothing essentially except bring in revenue?
Mm-hmm.
Or do we need policemen on the street doing police work?
Mm-hmm.
You know, so that's
especially with our current
shortage.
1, 2, 3.
Change the uniforms, hold them accountable, and put more cops on the street.
Mm-hmm.
That's going to be huge, and it can be done. That can be done administratively. The chief, the new chief, can do that. I'll put more guys on the street. I'll rearrange the traffic division. I'll get new uniforms for these guys, and I'll make them all two-man cars. They would love the chief. They would love the mayor.
Well, I got a new concept for the chief.
But
we're going to make the union president, the chief, and we're going to do away with the officers, and they're going to be officers within the union.
Okay.
Are you getting my drift?
I get you.
You're going to try to get rid of the union?
No. My point is that they're the police. I mean, they're the ones that are basically on the beat. That's what we're talking about, Don.
Got me?
So Daryl Turner would be the chief for now, you understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
As an interim aspect of it. And then my point is that as we, because they're going to sign off on him with no problem.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And he's very familiar with all those folks, because they're constantly calling up to haul and whatever, and let them do the job.
Yeah.
And then the commanding chief of the police department is the mayor.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
He is.
I.e., we the people are really supposed to be in charge, because we elect that person, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then policy is developed through us, right?
Mm-hmm.
Policy. And then once we sign off on the policy, we put a training package with it, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then we tell the whole public about this is what the policy is, here's the training, this is how police are supposed to react to this piece, and sell it to the people, and hey, what do you think?
Right.
That's not too difficult, is it?
No,
think?
It's not. It's really fairly simple in my mind.
That's right.
You know.
We'll tell that to Ted. Will you tell that to Ted?
I'll tell him, sure, you bet.
Okay, we'll share that with you, Ted. Okay, good. But no, we need to do something. And maybe you have some ideas out there. Maybe you're sitting out there talking about these issues and whatever. We're talking about the issues. And please, we're not biased. We're just sharing with you publicly about what's on our mind. You can do the same thing.
Yeah.
You can do the same thing. So all you have to do is call your neighbors and call the local policeman. They're constantly asking if you want to ride along. You don't have to ride along. Just have the cop ride along to your house with a group of folks and talk about the thing. Because what do you want to look at when you ride along? You want to look at that work, right?
Yeah.
Well, what the policeman want to know is that, why are you shooting at me? You know what I mean? What's the problem? Can I do a better job? What would it take for me to do a better job and I be more acceptable? I mean, you know, am I doing the job? That kind of deal. And out of that, you never know. You get all kinds of good ideas. I found Don and Teresa. I mean, now all of a sudden here they are. The man wrote the book. I mean, he didn't even know how to write before he met me.
That's right. That's right.
He's written two editions.
I spent 18 years learning how to write.
That's right. Till you met me. Yeah. Till you met Bruce. Yeah. And then I said, hey, man, you need to sit down and tell me about your ideas. Put them down in writing because I can't understand. I didn't understand what you were saying. Yeah. But now it's a good read. It's a good read, and you'll even recognize some of the photos and I mean, it's just a good read. I think about Smitty. Every time I think about the department, I think about Smitty. Mm-hmm. And he told me, he said, Bruce, because I had a Marine Corps uniform, I was a recruiter. He said, you need to join the force. He said, you could just go right on up through there. You could use the police department and get into there. Yep. And I didn't do that. I said, no, I'm about community policing. And as I said, I think I might have made the right choice because now that I've met you, I'm in good shape. I don't have no problem. But anyway, folks, that's just a little side note, if you will. But again, I'm trying to be redundant, but I want to be redundant. Get with your neighbors. And if Ted doesn't want to come to this particular spot, call him to your, he works for you. You're paying the bill.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Sit down with him and say, hey, look here, give me your rationale for getting a chief outside of this community.
Not
ask him why.
Idea.
What's his rationale aspect
not a
of
good
it?
Idea.
And if you got a better idea as to why we should get someone outside, then share it with him. But better yet, come over here on the Oregon Voters Digest and share it with us so we can share it to the public at all.
Yeah.
Because it has to be for everybody.
And you can email Ted Wheeler. His email, his professional email is on the internet. You can find it in 5 minutes.
Well, he didn't answer me, so I don't know why. Yeah, maybe he can answer Don. Did he answer you, Don?
I haven't talked to him yet.
He hasn't talked to him yet. I have not talked with him yet. But anyway.
Those kind of people don't have time for us.
Ted, you know, it's like anything. Ted, you know, you're a family man and this, that, and the other. We want you to enjoy your job because it's a tough, tough job being the mayor. It's not just about police.
Yeah.
It's everything. We got parks. We got all kinds of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
We got education issues. We got housing issues. We got homeless issues. It's a tough job, so you're going to need some support.
Yeah.
And we're here. We want to help. I want to help.
And the situation with Ted Wheeler is also, if he does select chief of police for Portland out of state, he's going to regret it.
Oh, yes.
It will just open up a huge can of worms, and he'll regret it.
Well,
my words.
And as the old saying goes, no man's an island. Well, no woman. If they had a woman, there'd be no woman as an island, right? Right? So be careful who you pick. Watch these consultants.
Mm-hmm.
You don't have the time. You know, if you want us to vet the consultant, have them come on the show, Oregon Voters Digest.
Well,
trust me, between Don and I, we'll help him out. Will you help me out, Don?
I'll help him.
There's
no
something
problem.
To be said for keeping leaders like that local.
Yes.
You know, the police officers in Portland, Oregon want a police chief they know, they have experience with.
They have experience and history with,
that they admire, that they have regard for. They don't want some stranger from out of state.
Yeah.
Portland's pretty unique.
Oh, yes. Mm-hmm.
You know, Portland's pretty unique, and you need somebody from here.
Right now.
Yeah.
Right now.
Yeah.
You need
but
somebody
it's changing.
From here.
It's changing right now, so we better be going on and pick someone locally, because we got a lot of folks coming in that are new, and as they're right.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they got the money, and they can buy the stuff cash.
Yeah.
I mean, it's filling up. You don't have any properties for sale anymore. And people are being pushed out. It's not being pushed out. They sold the property.
Yeah.
You don't have to
sell. I can't recognize Portland anymore. It's lost all of its livability for me.
Jesus.
The rent is going through the roof.
It's
depressing.
Again, that's another big job. So how's he going to answer that?
Yeah. He's got his work cut out.
And he's
out
a
for
resident.
Him.
He's not
He's
not from outside. He lives here in Portland.
He's got his work cut out for him because there's a huge homeless problem. There's a huge problem with homeless families, with low-income people not being able to afford housing. I mean, he's got his work cut out for him.
Portland has a huge heroin problem.
Yeah,
yeah, we have a
that's
big
the
heroin
other
problem
issue.
Too.
That's
has a huge heroin
okay.
problem.
Yeah. And those people like to eat.
Yeah.
And they want heroin first.
Yeah.
And we need to get them off. What are we going to do? You know,
you're seeing all this activity locally out in Lentz.
Yeah,
and that's
Lentz.
Where a lot of their heroin is. That they're picking up needles all the time. So
the Lentz area is just
Portland
a huge problem.
You see them on the street corners, right down here downtown. When I'm downtown every day, they're nodding out on the street. Yeah. Or
well, we got an agency giving them for free.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
it's terrible.
So you got the dope. Here's the needle.
Yeah. Yeah, lints is a really big problem, and a lot of people in that area are really angry that city council members aren't taking it seriously. And we have a friend, Thomas Legg, who's an activist, who's just a really great spokesman and really understands the issue. He's a member of that group. What's the group called?
Lints Active Watch.
Mm-hmm. On Facebook, and he goes to meetings, and he's just a wonderful
person. Community people trying to protect their community.
Right, they're trying. They're going out, and they're going out and picking up trash and dirty needles. I mean, they're doing things that they shouldn't have to do,
you know? But it's a sad note. I mean, I hate to bring up the races again. These are a bunch of white folks.
Yeah.
So maybe that's why they give them the needle. I mean, if it was a bunch of black folks, they wouldn't be getting the needle. They say, well, you're going to die. I mean, I hate to put it that way, but I don't want to be so clear. But my point is that we got to get to the point we can get over that particular issue.
It's
about people, and it's about livability and this, that, and the other. These are loved ones that are out there that have to get out there on the pipe and this, that, and the other.
Yeah. Yeah.
We got to make some jobs, baby. We need some jobs. Mm-hmm. We need a roof over one's head.
Yeah.
You need to eat.